And welcome back to HBO Mak. I'm Makenna. Joining me as always is Brandon. Hello, Brandon. How are you today?
Doing fine, Makenna. Doing just fine.
Great. We'd love to hear it.
Yeah. There's some technical difficulties on this side. So if this podcast gets interrupted or gets weird, just, you know, things aren't working quite right. Mm-hmm. So, you know.
And that's what is that called when they disclaimer? That's
yes.
A disclaimer for mm-hmm. the episode. We watched
this. Yeah, anything that bad that happens is because my internet's not working right.
Yes, everything bad. That's a blanket statement. We're wrapping up the love month of the February with Pride and Prejudice, the movie, not the book.
Yes, we don't review books.
No, we do not review books. So I'm going over some facts, figures real quick. Like, we're going right into the facts and figures, you know? I'm excited to talk about this movie, okay? Okay.
Okay.
This movie was released November 11th, 2005 in the United States. It was released. It was a whole bunch of random release dates. But we are in the United States, so I will say when it is released in the United States.
Did it get released in a different year anywhere else?
I don't... Because
everybody calls this Pride and Prejudice 2005. That is what people refer to this movie as.
Yeah, I think... I mean, it's probably... For that, it might be because it's been adapted a whole bunch of times. But... Oh, come on.
Well, there's actually... There's only other one film adaptation of this.
Oh, 1940. I see that. Bunch of TV miniseries. Yeah, with...
Who's... Is that Laurence Olivier? Or is it,
Let's see here. That is... Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, it's Olivia.
Yeah. I've heard that one's pretty decent.
Yeah, I've... Maybe next year.
Well, I think if we're going to do another version of this, we're going to do the miniseries with Colin Firth.
Yes.
Yeah, there's the miniseries, the BBC one, where Colin Firth plays Mr. Darcy.
Oh, that's got to be good.
I've heard he's really good in it.
It was... Sorry. I had a bunch of Skittles later, and for some reason it's giving me the hiccups. It was released in 2005 in the UK at the Toronto International Film Festival, and then January 2006 in France. So maybe... There you go.
Okay.
It had a budget of $28 million, box office, $121.6 million, made a lot of money.
Good return.
Very good return. Let me tell you what, they knew what they were doing there. Four Oscar nominations, including Best Actress, I can talk, and Best Art Direction. So there's some deviations, of course. This is based on Jane Austen's book, Pride and Prejudice. Which I believe was released in 1797? I don't remember. I only say that because this movie is set in 1797, but the book takes place in the early 19th century. So a couple years off, but enough to, like, it's different in terms of, like, the era or whatever.
There's, like, a war going on in the movie, so yeah. I imagine that some differences there.
Wars... do make some differences, from what I've heard. They're also, like, deviations from the dialogue in the movie, or the book in the movie, although a lot of it is similar. In the book, it's just from Elizabeth's point of view, but this one, you see more Darcy and Bingley and everyone to appear more human. And Elizabeth's personality is a bit different in the book and the movie. Those are the main ones that I found. I haven't read Pride and Prejudice.
Yeah, it sounds mostly like they just adapted it
to
be a movie instead of a book. Like, that's what...
That's
what you do.
Did you read Pride and Prejudice, the book?
I tried to.
Yep, that's how I was.
I've tried to read a couple Jane Austen books, and I would really like to, but they're It's like I can't read like Charles Dickens. I can't read any of that shit because I don't know what you're trying to tell me.
That's how I don't, was.
What are you saying?
I tried to read The Scarlet Letter last year and I couldn't get into it because it's just like I don't know what's I don't understand. I wish I could read Old English, but I can't.
Yeah. I have a real hard time reading anything from before the 20th century.
That's how I am. That's exactly how I am. That's like a hard cutoff.
Like it's like I've read like several Shakespeare plays and stuff, but those read a lot easier because it's almost all dialogue and stuff, so you can just kind of like have the conversations and like figure out what they're trying to say. He also like invented a bunch of like words that we would consider to be more modern and stuff because he was, you know,
Willie Shakes
he's making up the word eyeball and shit, you know.
Man, I wish we could have him on the show. Can you imagine?
Oh, yeah. Oh, Billy Shakespeare?
Oh, Billy Shakespeare. Bill is his friend.
Do you know the Pittsburgh Steelers? The first ever draft pick by the Pittsburgh Steelers was a guy named Bill Shakespeare.
No way. Was it him?
Yeah. Do you know what his nickname was?
God, what?
The Merchant of Menace.
Yes! That's amazing!
Yeah.
Oh. That's good. That's very good. I'm a big fan of that. Let me tell you what.
It's pretty sweet.
That's very good. Where was I? Oh, yeah. Yeah, I didn't... We had to read it. I'm going back to Pride and Prejudice book. We had to read it going into junior year of high school. I did not. I got maybe halfway through the first chapter, and then I just went on, like, the Cliff Notes or whatever, because we had to fill out a packet. We had to fill out a stupid packet for that class for English. About the book, but I just got them all. I was able to figure it out through Cliff Notes or Spark Notes or whatever.
Yeah, I'm trying to think, like, if I've really read any novels from, like, before the 20th century. Like, I really can't think of any.
That's why I'm trying to think, too. Because No, I don't think I have. Not yet. I have a few on my bookshelf that I'm, like, kind of nervous to read because I don't know if they're going to get read or not.
Oh, you know what? You know what? I've read a bit of Mark Twain. I like Mark Twain.
Oh, okay. Yeah, Mark Twain's good. Yeah, we read a bit in school, I think.
And, I guess some H.G. Wells.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, War of the Worlds was published in 1898. That's crazy.
Wow.
That book, I mean, it's probably just because I've seen so many, like, adaptations of it and stuff, but that feels like a book that was written in, like, 1913 or something.
Yeah. Well, when That's was crazy. That one on the radio that caused chaos?
That would have been in, like, the 40s or 50s.
Yeah.
Because that was Orson Welles, and that was before, like, Citizen Kane and all that.
That's one of my favorite stories. Or like historical things.
Yeah, it's pretty sweet.
In history.
But yeah, like I've tried to read some Jane Austen. I've tried to read like The Count of Monte Cristo. Or yeah. I've tried to read Charles Dickens and stuff. And I'm just like, talk like a normal person, please. I can't figure out what you're trying to tell me.
My brain's already can't interpret in general, let alone. Old English.
It's like everything has to be like you have to use like six words for every like
can you imagine
word you want to say.
Talking like that? Like while I was watching Pride and Prejudice, like Keira Knightley's like 20 or whatever, playing Elizabeth, and I'm assuming she's around that same age in the book. Like, can you imagine being a 20-year-old and talking like that? Like,
I'm gonna be honest with you. I really, really liked this movie. I couldn't understand half of what was going on. Like, I couldn't understand what they were saying for half the movie.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't figure out, like, there are a couple plot points in this movie where I'm just like, I don't know.
I have no idea.
And I'm just trying to figure it out from context.
I have to use the tone. I got to see what's happening visually. And then maybe some of it will make sense.
I was filling in some blanks because I had seen Bridget Jones's Diary, and I'm like, okay, well, I know what this happens in that movie, so I can kind of fill in the blanks here. But like the whole subplot where like the sister ran off.
I didn't understand.
I have no idea why that happened. I don't know how it happened. No, I don't know really. I vaguely know how it got resolved because it like ties in with like the ending of the movie.
Right.
Like it's explained. But I was so confused by all that.
Still vague. Like I get like Darcy did whatever, but I don't know exactly what he like. He paid the money, but like, how did he? I don't know. I don't get it. But
yeah, I totally missed that.
I don't know why did Bingley leave? Like he just like randomly.
Okay,
like,
that one I got.
Jane. He thought Jane didn't like him back.
No, so Darcy convinces Bingley to leave.
That's right. Okay, that's a whole thing.
Yeah, you get that reveal while they're in church. That was actually really clever. I that was like, oh wow, this is awesome. But yeah, he convinces Bingley to leave because he sees the way their mom acts around him and stuff.
Okay.
And he's like, oh, they're trying to play you. But she wasn't. She wasn't.
Mm-mm. She wasn't. There is actual affection.
And also his sister is a bitch.
Yeah, I couldn't figure out if she's like supposed to be good or bad. I could not figure
when
that
they
out.
When they were in that room and like Darcy's like writing or something and they're all just like walking around talking and stuff. I didn't understand a single fucking word that they were saying in that entire scene.
I couldn't figure it out. Like, was some of it sarcastic? I don't know.
I had no idea what was happening. I liked it. I liked the vibe of it. It was like, ooh, this is like, it's like flirty. It's shot really well. It's like, but I'm like, I don't know what they're saying though.
Good luck. I must have been terrible trying to memorize those lines too. Like they had to have, I should have probably looked this up. I wonder if they had like an expert from that time period to explain everything.
I'd imagine that they like all these people have done some amount of like stage acting stuff when they're coming up,
that is
and so like
true.
You just like these they do the Shakespeare's and stuff, so they're saying all kinds of complicated
that is,
shit.
That is very true. Yeah, no, that makes sense. Let me give you some more fun facts. Darcy's actor. How do you pronounce his last name? Matthew McFadden. He doesn't have very good eyesight. So, at the end when he's like in the mist or whatever, Joe Wright, the director, had to wave a red flag so he knew which way which direction to go.
That's funny.
His slight confusion makes a lot more sense in that scene. Emma Thompson has an uncredited and unpaid rewrites. She gets a special thanks in the credits, but she, oh my gosh, I deleted the screenshot. Hold on. I think it was two scenes that she, like, okay, that she helped, like, rewrite and redo. She did the scene.
Additional dialogue is what she's credited with.
Ooh. She did the scene where Charlotte tells Elizabeth that she's gonna marry Mr. Collins, and when Elizabeth tries to tell Mr. and Mrs. Gardiner, is it Gardiner? Yeah, sure. That looks like it. And Mr. Darcy about Lydia's elopement with Mr. Wickham. I guess Keira Knightley's walking in and out of the room was Emma Thompson's idea, according to the DVD commentary. There we go. The actresses who played the Bennett sisters, they went up to the house location in Kent, and they played like a sardines, which I don't really know. It's like as a version of hide and seek, I guess, to better get acquainted with the house and with each other, which I thought was very cute. Just playing good old hide and seek.
they got some like really good actresses for the Bennett sisters. Like when they were like, because like Carrie Mulligan is awesome, and she's been in a bunch of stuff, and like in this, she's just like, she's like there. Jenna Maloney, she's awesome. Like they got Rosamund Pike for this.
Yeah, she like, turned down Rita Skeeter. All the Bennett sisters. She was supposed to play Rita Skeeter in Goblet of Fire. She turned this down to play this. Yeah, that's what it said on IMDb.
Good move.
Good move. I agree.
Good
I could not imagine her as Rita Skeeter. The scene in which Mr. Bingley rehearses proposing to Jane was almost completely improvised. It was supposed to be shortened, but they just kept going. Bingley and Darcy, the actress who played them, just kept going with the whole, like, rehearsing how Bingley was going to propose, which I thought was another very cute scene, because that's adorable that he was rehearsing the proposal. That's very sweet. And then the actress, my final fact and figure, the actress who played Georgiana Darcy played her own piano music during her piano scenes.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that was very nice. Her name is, I'm going to look his name, Tamsin Merchant. Yeah, I thought that was very cool. I enjoyed that thoroughly.
Nice.
Yeah, there were some good facts and figures during this. It's a big movie. People like Pride and Prejudice.
It's true, yeah, people do.
I've got a very important question for you.
Okay.
If you had to choose between Mr. Bingley and Mr. Darcy, which suitor would you choose? Or if you want, you can go with Mr. Collins, Mr. Wickham. I don't know, whichever suitor you want.
Well, why would I choose between... Because, like, Mr. Darcy and Mr. Bingley aren't competing for Elizabeth, well, right?
Yeah, but, like, if you say you're a single lady in that time, who okay. would you want?
I like Mr. Bingley. I like Mr. Bingley. I do, he seemed too. Nice.
He... Yes, I agree. Like, he seemed like he actually liked Jane and wasn't just, like, trying to get a wife or whatever, which is nice.
Yeah.
You know,
Mr. Darcy's great, too. I like Mr. Darcy.
I do, too. I'm a big fan of the enemies to lover trope. So, like, you know, that was delightful. Name Mr. Darcy.
This movie doesn't feel... I accidentally hit my mute button.
Okay, I wasn't sure if you cut out.
This movie doesn't super feel like an enemies to lovers thing the way it does in like Bridget Jones's Diary or like other like Sense and Sensibility like esque things I've seen before. Mm-hmm. Because like I never really got the impression that Mr. Darcy wasn't into Elizabeth.
He just
seemed like really awkward and aloof the entire time, and the entire time Elizabeth just didn't like Mr. Darcy.
That is very true. Okay, yeah, you make a good point. It's
And I mean I would I don't know how it is in the book or whether or not like I don't know, Mr. Darcy seemed like just a good dude the entire time. And I was like, you should ease up on this guy. I mean when you find out that he convinced Bingley to leave and stuff, you're like, oh, that's fucked up. Because you assume it's like, oh, because he doesn't want him marrying like a poor But then like right after that he shows up and is like, hey, by the way, Elizabeth, I'm super into you. I was like, okay, so it's not a problem, man.
BT dubs. Oh, who is... I couldn't figure out... Who is Judy Dench? Like, Catherine or whatever. I think that's...
Dame Judy Dench?
Dame Judy Dench. Who is...
I assume that she was, like, a duchess or something.
But, like, how is she connected to everyone? Because, like... It seemed like she was everyone's aunt.
Yeah, because so she's like the because like once when you will like you marry off all your kids and stuff.
Yeah,
and so like so for that I would imagine like as like she's supposed to be like the head like lady of that area, that like all the noble families would be related to her. It's like how, like, if you go look at it, like during like World War One times, literally every single nation in World War One was like either Queen Elizabeth's niece or was married to Queen Elizabeth's niece.
That makes more sense now.
Yeah, that's how I assumed it worked out.
Mr. Collins, then. Who, okay, now I'm just gonna ask you who everyone is. Who is he? Like, is he? He's like a. Is he an actual cousin? Like, is he like related by blood? Or like, how is?
No, what, I thought that he married her cousin.
Yeah, because he. But like, before that,
he's like. So the Judy Dench was like his patron or whatever. I think is what he says.
Yeah.
Is that he's running that church or whatever, and she's, like, paying for him to do it and all that. I think that that's what's going on.
Okay. Hmm. Interesting.
I don't know. Like, I wasn't... Again, I'm kind of dumb, and the movie talks really complicated, so I was missing a lot of this, too.
I didn't even... I was on a puzzle. Like, usually I would move it to be in front of me, but I was like, there's no use in trying... for me to read the closed captioning. Like, I'm not gonna be able to figure out what the heck's going on. Like, I'm gonna be lost kind of the entire time. We've got a bunch of people in this movie. Let me tell you what.
Oh yeah, a whole bunch of people.
We already mentioned Judy Dench. Dame Judy Dench. Donald Sutherland is in this.
Donald fucking Sutherland's in this. Ah, I love Donald Sutherland.
So good. He's so good. And I just got off of watching MASH the movie. So he pops in. I'm like, oh shit, that's Hawkeye Pierce right there. That's the original Hawkeye Pierce showing up. He's great. I did read like one of like the differences from the book is that like in the movie, they made him more like fatherly and warm, which I thought was really nice.
That's like my favorite part of the movie.
<I know. laughs> And I would be remiss if I did not bring up the Downton Abbey. Penelope Wilton is in this. She plays the aunt that like with Elizabeth when I don't know they're in the woods at some point, and the uncle who like
and they go to Mr. Darcy's house.
Yeah, I don't.
That's who she's traveling with.
I still don't understand why they're traveling. Like at one point they're at Cath and they're like, we're gonna travel, da, 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 and then we'll go to
Darcy's house. So like they sent one or two of the daughters up to a town where like all officers were camped out for the war, and then the aunt and uncle are going up there, and they're like, hey, you want to come with us? Well, like we'll go up there and meet up with them. I guess that's what I think happened.
I don't know. I just looked up.
I think that's what happened.
They're just hanging out, and they're like, oh, there's Darcy's house. Let's go walk in and see what and see his art.
Yeah, it's just like you walk in his fucking like his the front room's just filled. It's like a museum in there. Like Jesus,
just casually walk in, and I don't get it. But Penelope Wilton is great, and I love her dearly. And I originally wrote her down in my notebook as Isabella Wilton because that's her character's name. Isabella is cousin Isabel is in her name in Downton Abbey. But no, her name is Penelope. She's great, and I love her. I love Downton Abbey. It's great. I love period pieces.
I like a period piece, too.
I really like, particularly with Downton Abbey, I like all the attention to detail. Like, with the clothes, and, like, the historic, I don't know. I just think it's so much fun.
Yeah.
Because obviously we didn't have cameras then, our good cameras. So I was like, oh, it's almost like we're there. We're in Downton Abbey. Well, it's not, I don't remember what the Downton Abbey place is actually called. But it's, man, you know, is there a place that we can add to our tour in Pride and Prejudice? Like, could we, because I didn't really look up a lot of the locations. I know some of it takes place in Kent. Like, is there, like, can we go to, like, I don't know.
They go to that one, like, palace or whatever that was pretty sweet where Judi Dench lived.
Let's go to Judi Dench's palace.
Okay. Or
we'll already be in the UK for Southampton to go to the Titanic Museum. You know, which I don't remember if we talked about this on the actual episode, but I was talking to my sister about this. We should go to the Titanic Museum where you get a person when you go in and they tell you, you go through their life and then they tell you if you make it at the end.
Oh, that's,
I think it's in like Kentucky or something. I don't know why.
It's, oh, I literally just heard about this on a podcast. yeah, it's somewhere on the East Coast.
Let's see, Titanic, oh God, I'm gonna look up Titanic Museum. There's one in Philly? Why is there one in Philly? I don't, there's so many Titanic museums. Get person. And then I think, oh, well.
It was at, I remember hearing it was at a super weird place.
Tennessee, Pigeon Forge, Tennessee. Oh, yes.
Really?
Yeah. Let's, oh my God, they got a big old replica of it. They got, oh, it's, their website's decorated in hearts for Valentine's Day. February is Sweetheart Month at Titanic. Oh my God, we can get combo offers. We can go to Dollywood.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, there's a shop. We can get some sweet Titanic merch. You can get a fleece throw. You get some keychains.
So I'm scrolling through just a book of several of these Titanic, and it seems that quite a few of them have where you get a name of a passenger.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Interesting.
Yeah. So the world, we'll just go to one of them.
Yeah. We're gonna have to compare and contrast all of them. But I mean,
there's a whole bunch.
We definitely have to go to the one in Southampton, though, because that is where Titanic happened, or they took off from. And then we'll go.
We should go to the. Go find the iceberg.
We're gonna take a boat over. That's how we find it. We can smell the ice.
I mean, honestly, the iceberg's probably not there anymore, right? Like, we got revenge for that.
Oh, yeah. All chopped up.
Yeah. Yeah. No, well, I think we heated up the water so much that it melted.
That's the real reason we did global warming.
Uh-huh. Yeah, right. Never again.
Never again. Did they release a second? Like, has there been, like, okay, this is going to sound really dumb. They released a Titanic sequel boat. Like, has there been, like, another big old boat that they're like, this is actually the Titanic, or, like,
Titanic
2?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh.
I think so. I can't think of what it is, but I feel like I remember hearing about this. The Titanic Museum that I had heard about,
mm-hmm.
where you do this whole thing with the name, it was in Vegas.
Oh.
Titanic, the Art of Exposition.
Oh, okay. Exhibition, that's a big word.
Yeah, and that's when, like, they have, like, a bunch of stuff from the Titanic built out in, like, the Luxor or whatever.
Oh. Hmm. Should we go to 3 Titanic museums?
Oh, and they have like, recreated, like, first-class bedrooms in there.
Oh, that's cool.
They have a reconstructed, like, staircase from the movie where you walk up.
Oh, the meet me at the clock. Let's go meet Jack at the clock.
Yeah. Yeah, so let's go to that one.
Let's go to that one.
You gotta go to TwitchCon? Go to TwitchCon. We'll go to the Titanic Museum when we go to TwitchCon.
Is TwitchCon at the same place as it was this year?
It's in Vegas this year.
Is it in Vegas? Oh my God.
Maybe. Yeah.
Maybe I'll go to TwitchCon specifically to see the Titanic Museum.
Yep.
That's it. Are you going to TwitchCon?
Planning on it.
Ooh, that's exciting. Don't go to the Titanic Museum without me.
Okay,
I won't. Promise me that. Thank you.
Okay.
Is there, like, is there, like, I don't know how they would do this. No, it's a dumb question. Never mind. Forget it. I talked myself out of my own question. I was going to ask if there's a Pride and Prejudice museum, but that's a stupid question, because how could they make a whole museum about
it? Is there, like, a Jane Austen museum?
Yeah, that's a better question. I mean, there's got
to be. You can go to Jane Austen's house.
We should go there. That's the Pride and Prejudice stop.
Yeah, we'll go to Jane Austen's house.
Let's do that. Where's she at?
Hampshire. The Hampshire cottage where Jane Austen lived and wrote her novels.
Guess what else is in Hampshire?
What?
Southampton.
Hey!
We're saving money! We can go. Oh, let's see. Jane Austen. We'll see how... I'll Google map it to see how close the two are. We could just take... No, not for Philadelphia. That's not what I want.
It's in Chawton. That's not a word that feels good in the mouth.
It's not. Okay, let's see. Okay, Jane Austen's house, a little bit outside of Southampton, but you know, it's closer than I thought it was gonna be. Titanic Museum.
You can get an annual pass to the Jane Austen house. Go as many times as you want.
No way. What if I miss something? Oh my god, we can get... Oh wait, no, not leave right now. Not 5:07 a.m. This is in England time. Let's say... I'm going to choose a random date just to see how far away it is. Let's see. We're departing our trip. No. We need a good chunk of time at the Jane Austen house. Oh, okay, never mind. It doesn't go that far.
Need to be there. I want to be there at least like 2 hours.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Then that's a decent... No, it doesn't go far out as far as April. Not that... Okay, let's say we'll go next week, the 28th.
Perfect. Book it.
Book it. It's like 2 hours. It's not bad. I thought we were going to be all the way up north. No, we're 2 hours. Or we could do hour 40 if we do... it's not called Regional Rail in England. What is that called again? I don't know. It's a railway station.
Ooh, they got some cool stuff in the gift shop.
Ooh, like what?
They got, it looks like they're selling like parasols and dresses and cups and...
Ooh, I gotta get a cup.
All kinds of stuff.
I'm gonna have to like read more up on Jane Austen before we go.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, we can get an ornament? Or a decoration? Sorry. Oh, gifts? Wow.
They have replicas of Jane Austen's gold and turquoise ring. There's Jane Austen tea made by Twinings.
Oh.
There's night dresses, exclusive stationery.
I see, wow. A Jane Austen duck. All kinds of stuff. And a teapot.
Jane Austen duck?
Rubber duck, sorry, I should say. We can get an I Heart Mr. Darcy tote bag.
Oh, hell yeah. Hell yeah, we're getting one of those. I need to get a teapot.
Ooh, what kind of teapot?
I feel like I would enjoy drinking tea more if I had a teapot. Instead of just making one in a mug, making a pot of tea, that feels like that seems like it would be more fun.
Now, to tell me, you think about your teapot, your future teapot, what's it look like?
So typically I like things to be rather like plain, like, so just like maybe just like a white teapot or like, just like not too decorative, you know?
Yeah. Are you going like a ceramic one or is it like,
yeah, I would like ceramic.
Yeah. You feel very sophisticated when you use one.
Yeah.
So teapots. So like, they're just... Is it hot water or is the tea in the pot as well? Or do you pour it into the tea bag?
Yeah, so I think what you do is like when you have the teapot, right? Is you use like the loose leaf tea.
Okay.
You put that in the pot and then you pour the hot water in there and let it brew in the pot. Mm-hmm. And you pour it out instead of doing like the tea bags.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense. Now, let me tell you a memory that just unlocked for me. In my sophomore year of high school, I took biology. and our teacher was British. And I don't remember why. I think it was, like, during some themed week. And during class, we had tea and crumpets.
Oh.
It was great. She had, like, jams and everything. And we all had little teacups. We were really scared we were going to break the... Because it was real... It was ceramic. It was breakable. But as far as I'm aware, nothing got broken that day. But it was a delightful time, and we didn't have to do biology, so good day in my book.
I would also be down for like a gimmicky like novelty teapot.
Yeah.
But like I don't have any ideas for that. You know, I'm not like on the lookout for like, oh, I want a teapot that looks like this.
Well, if you were a bigger Jane Austen fan, you could get one that's a teapot, but in the middle is her books with look like her books with
maybe get a countdown teapot. Like, do they sell those or do you have to win them?
That maybe on Etsy? Surely someone on Etsy is making countdown teapots. We'll just have to get on countdown and we'll get you on countdown.
Okay. Perfect. Yeah. Well, I have to win Countdown.
Oh, that's
not gonna happen.
That is very true. We'll get you on 8 out of 10 Cats' Countdown on our road to British panel shows.
Yeah, I can stand a chance.
Countdown teapot. Let's see here. Mm. Oh, what is this? Oh, that's this is Facebook. Bachelor, see if you can spot it on 8 out of 10 Kessa's Countdown. I think. Hold on. Let me look on this person's website. They make novelty teapots. Alice in Wonderland. Best of British around the world. Oh, this is interesting. Hold on. We gotta look at this one. I can get you. It's it looks like a coffee maker. This one looks like an oven with an American flag.
It's a teapot that looks like a coffee maker.
Yeah. It's an espresso machine. Sorry, I apologize. I'm on
okay.
Yeah.
I'm looking up, I'm just on Amazon looking at teapots and nothing too fancy.
Oh yeah.
Tell you that. Nothing too fancy on Amazon. Yeah.
This is let's see. Oh, it's I think are these just the people who made? This one looks like a bathtub.
There's one with like ladybugs on it.
Oh, that's cute.
A bathtub.
A bathtub.
Okay.
Steam train? Oh, the white rabbit from Alice in Wonderland, but he's a teapot.
See, the thing is that like when you look this up, you also get kettles, and I don't need a kettle. I have a kettle.
Yeah.
I need a teapot.
Need a teapot. It's.
I have a really nice kettle. Like I'm set in the kettle department.
No more kettles, only teapots. I think we have three, like, kitty teapot sets from growing up with like dolls and everything. We would always fill them up with water, and that's how we did, you know, tea time or whatever. It was very fun. It was a good time. That's when we wanted to feel like posh, I guess would be the best way to describe it, you know, fancy.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's, you know, it's the closest we can get. And we didn't break anything, so that was good. So yeah, we should go to Jane Austen's house.
Yeah, love it. Love the
she's
idea.
She's got mugs too. She's got
mugs. Gotta get a mug. Love getting a mug where I go somewhere.
I heard she made them all. They've survived this long. Novelty mugs.
She made all the mugs.
With her own quotes from her books. <It's>...
So, Mac, what did you think of Pride and Prejudice 2005?
I really enjoyed it. I remembered, like, the general plot from when we did it in high school. But not specifics. I mean, obviously, because I also didn't read it. But it was nice. I had a delightful time with it. It was only 2 hours, which was also nice.
Yeah.
It's like you got it all done. What'd you think?
I really liked it.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of the camera work is really, really good in it. Some of it, they do the little push zooms just a little too many times.
Yeah, I thought there were a couple of times like, wait, what? What? Why is no?
There's one that's like egregiously like, why are we doing this?
Yeah,
where it's when she gets back home from going and visiting her cousin, and it's Keira Knightley and Rosamund Pike, and it's like shot on Keira Knightley. Push zoom in a little bit.
Yeah,
and it cuts to Rosamund Pike. Push zoom in a little bit. I'm like, okay, this makes sense. And then it goes back to Keira Knightley, and it does a push zoom again. And I'm like, okay, that one's not good.
No,
that one's bad.
It's stop. Yeah. There. I wish I could remember this specific thing, but it was Keira Knightley again, and they did something happened. And they cut to Keira Knightley, and they did a push zoom in at the same time. It was like, we know she's shocked.
I liked most of the push zooms. It was just like, it felt like that they like had the toy and were just doing it a little too much.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But like the blocking in this movie is really, really good. Mm-hmm. Of just like after she gets proposed to by the priest guy and she runs out to the little pond or whatever, and like, yeah, the way it's framed where she's like over there and then her parents walk into camera, and then later when they do the rehearsal scene of Bingley's proposal, they do it in the exact same like shot layout over at the pond. It's really nice. And then like when they're at like the ball, they do like a cutaway to like the girls run into like a side hall, and like the framing of that shot of like you can see the party in the background, but there's like they're set on this wall over to the side of it and stuff. They thought about the shots a lot in this movie, and it's really, really good. The camera work is fantastic. It's fun to watch.
I'm excited. I really want to rewatch it again just to focus more on the camera work, just because the first time I was trying to figure out what was happening. I want to rewatch it again, see how.
Yeah, I bought halfway through watching this movie, I bought it on Blu-ray.
There you go.
Because I was like, this movie's really like, Peacock is terrible. I'll tell you what, like Peacock, the streaming on Peacock, the quality's not very good. And then I kept having like sometimes like the dialogue would go out of sync.
Oh, that's weird.
And it was really bothering me. And I was like, well, Peacock sucks, so I'm just gonna buy this on Blu-ray because I'm watching this movie again. I really liked it.
Yeah, It's just a good old love story. I don't know. I really liked it. It wasn't just Darcy and Elizabeth getting together either. It was like Jane and Bingley, and then the other sister who randomly ran off. Like, oh, people were doing the love thing. It was nice.
Yeah, and like the cousin who gets married, it ends up working out pretty good for her. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, everybody's having a great. And Donald Sutherland is just so good in this movie. Like when the mom wants her to marry the priest and he goes out there and he's like, okay, well, so you make your decision and you're not going to talk to one of your parents ever again, because either you're going to either you marry him, if you don't marry him, your mother will never talk to you. And if you do, I'll never talk to you again. And so I was like, yeah, hell yeah. Go Donald Sutherland. That's awesome. And then at the end of the movie, like when Darcy like asks for his permission to marry him, and like he's like, do you I don't think you like this guy. Like you constantly talk about how you hate this guy. Like, I'm not gonna let you marry him because you don't like him. Like I like that he's like looking out for her. He doesn't just want her to marry off. He's like, no, I want you to be like be happy with the guy that you marry. I'm not just gonna let you just run off with a guy.
Yeah,
I like that.
Very sweet. He's a very good father looking out for his daughters. It's okay if the thing he's, you know, losing money or whatever. He just wants his daughters to be happy. It just so happened they also married rich men. So, yeah, everyone wins. The mom.
Yeah.
The mom's winning.
Oh, yeah. The mom's crushing it. She's getting everything she wanted. But I like that the dad, like she's seen, like, the mom is, like, just, like, so worried. Like, she wants the daughters out of the house so bad. And the dad just, like, genuinely can't seem to be bothered to care about anything.
The dynamic is so good. We should get Donald Sutherland on the show.
Oh yeah, I love Donald Sutherland.
Yeah,
because he can do anything. Like he can do comedic roles. He can mm-hmm. do serious roles. He plays the bad guy really well.
Yeah,
he plays just an old dad really well. Like yeah, Donald Sutherland's the best.
Well yeah, like before last week, all I knew him as Cornelius Snow from The Hunger Games. He does that very well.
Yeah. Super bad guy.
Super bad guy, like super ultra bad guy. He's bad guy.
Bad guy.
Bad guy doing bad things. But yeah, he does very well-rounded actor.
He's gotta be up there. Like he's gotta be like 80s at least, yeah?
87. Look at that. What a man.
Yeah. Oh yeah, he's been in so many movies.
Oh yeah, so all of them.
Yeah, Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
Oh, he's got his own filmography Wikipedia page, so you know he's good then.
Yeah,
that's how we know.
He's that means he's been in a lot of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, he's.
He plays like the mentor in like the original Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Oh, look at that!
Yeah.
Huh. Yeah, he's
got a kid, Kiefer. Kiefer Sutherland?
No, I don't think so.
He's Jack Bauer on 24.
Oh, okay. Wow.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
Yeah, Kiefer Sutherland. He's a big actor.
He
played Big Boss in Metal Gear Solid 5.
Wait, Sutherland or Kiefer? Kiefer or Donald?
Kiefer Sutherland.
Oh, okay.
Kiefer.
Okay. Wanna make sure we were all. Wow. Let me see his filmography then. He's also got a discography. I'm sorry.
I don't. Kiefer was never really like a huge movie. Like he was a TV guy for the most part.
Mm.
But like when he was young, like Lost Boys, Young Guns, Flatliners. He did some stuff when he was younger, and then he mostly became like a TV actor.
Oh.
He plays the creepy doctor in Dark City. That movie's awesome.
Let's see here. Yeah, got a lot of things. The Call of Duties, Metal Gears, 24 the game.
Yeah, 24 was the big thing for Kiefer Sutherland. Now, he's Jack Bauer.
I've always been confused about 24.
Okay.
So I know
Okay, so the gimmick of 24.
Yeah.
Was that it took place in real time.
Oh.
So they were like hour-long episodes.
Mm-hmm.
24 episodes, I think. I think that's how the breakdown was.
Oh.
And so you watched a full 24 hours of Jack doing spy shit or whatever.
That's cool.
Yeah, 24 episodes, each one an hour long. And I mean, obviously, you know, commercial breaks or whatever, but yeah, you watch the whole show takes place in real time.
So then are the seasons consecutive days, like do they fall one after another
no,
or are
no,
they different days?
No.
Wow, so
no,
much.
No, yeah, each one's like takes place at like a terrorist attack happens or something, or you know, some conspiracy happens. Jack Bauer's got to go torture like 70 people a season. That's mostly what happens in the show, is Jack Bauer tortures a bunch of people.
Oh.
But yeah, every episode would open up and it would be like, the following takes place in real time between the hours of 5 a.m. and 6 a.m.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Is it a good show? Like, overall?
I doubt it holds up very well. Because it's like super like pro CIA, like Jack, like it's one of those shows where, like, when you watch it now, like, Jack Bauer is clearly, like, a bad guy doing, like, really bad things. But, like, the show's just like, yeah, he's getting the job done. He's because, like I'm not joking. He tortures, like, hundreds of people throughout the show. Like, he does some, like, super shade. Like, he's killing a bunch of people. Like, yeah. So I doubt it holds up very well. But at the time, it was, like, it was a really big deal of a show.
Interesting. Yeah, because I had always heard about it, but I didn't my brain couldn't figure it out. But so, there we go. That's our 24 update. Or 24 yeah. Fun facts, I guess. the more you know. You got any final thoughts on the prides and the prejudices?
I really like it. One thing that about this movie that I was a bit worried about going in. That's right, because this always happens in the romance movies, especially the ones that start off the way Pride and Prejudice is. Because it starts off, she's like walking around, she's like reading a book and stuff, and she's all, and you know, she's like, oh, like, yeah, you know. I expected the movie to be like, oh yeah, and like nobody's interested in her. Like she's like, you know, in her she's too old to be married already. And nobody she can't find a man and nobody wants to. And I'm like, she's Keira Knightley, okay? Yeah. She's like she's ridiculously beautiful, okay? Like you cannot convince me that people do not want to marry Keira Knightley, which is great because of like almost every single male character you meet up to that point. Throughout the rest of the movie, they all want to marry Keira Knightley. And I was like, okay, good. I was worried you were going to try to convince me that she was unattractive. And you're just, that's not going to happen.
People need the Knightley.
I hate when movies do that. When you have like an obviously like beautiful woman in a movie and they pretend like she's like not attractive.
Yeah.
Like, come on. What are we doing?
I read that like the director Joe Wright didn't want to cast her at first because she was so beautiful, and then I guess like she also had like tomboyish personality or whatever, and they're like, okay, you're in. Quarantine.
She plays it really well, where she is like she just talks shit to like everybody throughout the entire movie,
great.
And you're like, okay, yeah, I can see why, like, she probably has trouble finding somebody to marry her, but, like, you can't convince me that she doesn't have suitors.
Find a blunt around the block. Yeah. Good movie.
Yeah. Great movie. I really liked it. I bet it's a movie that I like the more I watch it, too, because I'll understand it more.
That's the other thing.
Yeah, I liked it.
And, you know, maybe it will be easier to understand if read in audiobook format. Because for me, I have trouble reading words sometimes, pronouncing words in my head, which makes it like some words aren't spelled how they're said. So I go years thinking that there's a lot of words, okay? A lot of words that aren't spelled the same that I just recently learned are...
I will say you did, before we started recording, you said foyer. Which is like an acceptable pronunciation of the word
foyer,
but I believe it is foyer.
Foyer, French word. Yeah, it's that other word. There's another word. Oh my gosh, I can't think of it. Never mind. But you know what'll help with that? If you listen to it on audiobook, and guess what? Uh-huh. Guess what we have. If you go to HBO Mak, no, if you go to audibletrial.com.
You're so good at ad reads.
I know, /HBO Mak. No.
It's audible.com/trial/HBO Mak, right?
Yeah, you are right.
I had the same problem with this a couple episodes ago. It's confusing.
It is confusing. But it's okay because it's in the description box.
Just go below audible.com/trial/HBO Mak. Mm-hmm. You will get 1 free month of Audible which includes one credit for an audiobook that you will get to keep regardless of if you renew the subscription or not. They also if you have a subscription, they have a bunch of like free audiobooks you don't have to spend a credit on. You don't get to keep those afterwards, but you can listen to a couple more. Mm-hmm. Like I just found out like 2001 A Space Odyssey is on there. Didn't have to spend a credit. I think I'm going to start reading that one. Mm-hmm. But also like I've heard the sequels to that are actually pretty good. Oh, so I might start going into the sequels of that. Hmm. But you can check out Pride and Prejudice read by Rosamund Pike, who is in this movie.
Oh, get out. Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. So I think I'm going to give that one a try. It is still, I normally do audiobooks when I'm working because I have a bunch of time. It's really convenient for me. It's how I've been able to get through so many books over the last couple of years because I'm at work and I have plenty of time to listen to audiobooks. You probably do too. Mm-hmm. But that book's like complicated and I'm not sure I'm going to be able to like do that while I work. So I might have to read something much dumber while I'm at work. But if you want to read something dumb while you're at work, audible.com/trial/HBO Max.
There you go. Link in the doobly-doo. Brandon, where can people find you on the internet if they want to find you?
They can find me on Twitter or Twitch or TikTok at Jose Ruckus.
There we go. You can follow me on Twitter at PotterPants212, but you should follow the show on Twitter at HBO Mak, HBO Mak. You can find us on the podcast services. You can find us on YouTube, youtube.com/@HBO Mak. Comment, like, subscribe. What should people comment this week?
Let us know. This is a tough one. We didn't really have many tangents this week.
No, we didn't.
We kind of stayed on script this week. I'm proud of us.
I am too. Go us.
Let us know, Mr. Bingley or Mr. Darcy. Which one did you like the most?
Who is your suitor of choice?
I like Mr. Bingley. He seemed nice and dumb.
Yeah.
Which is like, that's kind of my vibe too, I think. I'm not always nice, but, you know, try to be.
comment who you want. Follow along. We got big things planned. Big things.
Yeah, there's gonna be several announcements coming up soon. So yeah, twitter.com/HBO Mak. Go give that a follow for all the updates going forward. Mm-hmm. Big stuff's happening with the podcast. So you're gonna want to know about that.
Happening. We're official. We got announcements. Big announcements. Giant.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, follow along, like, and follow and rate all the stars. I don't know how to end this one. You know. There's not a good old,
Yeah, it's really not like a seminal line from this movie
no.
to close it on.
I will say I've got one from Titanic that my sister's been saying all the time.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so I'll end it with this very sentimental line. I'd rather be his whore than your wife. Thank you.